This video is the first in a set of four explaining the Keynesian theory of aggregate demand, specifically the ISLM interpretation. This model is very important to short-run macroeconomics and attempts to explain shifts in the aggregate demand curve and what determines national income for any price level. These topics are usually taught in an intermediate macroeconomics class, and these videos are intended as a visual aid to further your understanding of the models. This video reviews the components of aggregate demand, income, the consumption function, taxes, finding equilibrium in this short-run model, and the factors affecting the slope and position of the aggregate demand curve. The second video covers the IS curve regarding the goods market, the third video covers the LM curve regarding the money market, and the final video puts the two together to find equilibrium in both markets. We begin our discussion of aggregate demand by looking at its components and their symbols. You will likely be familiar with the concept of aggregate demand, the total demand for all finished goods in the economy. It is usually broken down into demand for the following factors: C for consumption, I for investment, G for government spending, and NX for net exports. Some textbooks break it down into exports and imports, but net exports are simply exports minus imports. Initially, we will only consider changes in consumption, making investment, government spending, and net exports exogenous to our model, which we designate by putting a horizontal bar over top of them. To begin, we're going to look at how consumption is related to income. We're going to break down consumption into its separate components, beginning with autonomous consumption. This is the base level of consumption. In this model, consumption cannot fall below the autonomous level, regardless of what people are making as income. Next, we have disposable income. This is after-tax income. Disposable income is multiplied by the coefficient C, the marginal propensity to consume. This tells us how much consumption increases for every $1 increase in income. The MPC coefficient can be between 0 and 1. Graphically, the consumption function displays the relationship between consumption and disposable income. Consumption, the dependent variable, is on the y-axis. Disposable income, the independent variable, is on the x-axis. The level of autonomous consumption determines the y-intercept. As you recall, this is the level of consumption when disposable income is zero. Marginal propensity to consume determines the slope of this curve. As disposable income increases from the left to right, it is modified by the MPC. A high MPC of 0.9, for example, would lead to a steep curve. A lower MPC would mean a more gradual slope. And there's the formula for the curve again. Now we're going to take a closer look at disposable income. This is an aggregate measure of all the income paid to households plus government taxes, such as welfare and social security, minus income taxes. As it's presented here, government transfers and taxes do not change relative to our dependent variable, income. Again, this is shown by the horizontal bar above the two exogenous variables. Generally, income taxes are some percentage of income. Although it's not that simple in practice, in this model, we're going to think of taxes as a flat rate denoted by the lowercase t. This coefficient could be any number between 0, meaning no taxes, and 1, meaning all income would be paid in taxes. This is then multiplied by income. Now that our disposable income has taxes incorporated into it, we're going to plug it back into the consumption function. Here is the consumption function as previously shown. Disposable income is now replaced with the tax rate formula. Some simple algebraic factoring will clean up this formula. The terms with income in them are grouped together, leaving the transfer payments to be multiplied by MPC. To simplify the bottom term, Y is taken out of the bracket, leaving 1 minus taxes, all multiplied by MPC. Putting it all together, we have an updated consumption function that includes income tax. Consumption equals autonomous consumption plus transfer payments plus MPC times 1 minus taxes times income. Next, we incorporate this updated consumption function into the aggregate demand equation. The first step is to separate the factors into exogenous and endogenous. Exogenous demand is represented by A bar. Investment, government spending, and net exports are exogenous because they aren't affected by national income in this model, so their value won't change when income changes. These factors will be grouped together at the bottom beside A bar. When we substitute the consumption function in for C, we see that there are some exogenous variables, such as exogenous consumption and transfer payments. These can be grouped down below with the other external factors. We can bring the two groups together with a simplified A bar to represent all the exogenous factors, and C times 1 minus T times Y, representing the determining factors. In this model, aggregate supply is equal to income at any point in time. Therefore, supply equals demand when aggregate demand equals income. When we have aggregate demand on the y-axis and income on the x-axis, equilibrium is reached at any point on this 45-degree angle, where the values for both axes are equal. The aggregate demand curve starts out on the y-axis at a value equal to the exogenous demand, A bar, and then continues upward with increasing levels of income. Equilibrium occurs when the two lines intersect. This indicates the equilibrium income and the equilibrium level of aggregate demand. Moving forward, we are going to see how equilibrium changes in reactions to change in the marginal propensity to consume. If a country becomes more inclined to spend their disposable income, their MPC is larger. An increase in the marginal propensity to consume creates a steeper aggregate demand curve. The point of origin is the same, but the steeper line crosses the equilibrium line at a higher point. This results in larger equilibrium values for aggregate demand and national income. Now we're going to examine the effects of change in the tax rate. An increase in the tax rate reduces the slope of the aggregate demand curve. This results in lower values for equilibrium income and equilibrium aggregate demand. A change in exogenous demand would result from a change in any of the following: autonomous consumption, transfer payments, investment, government spending, or net exports. If there is an increase in any of those components, the entire aggregate demand curve would shift up. This would lead to a higher equilibrium value for aggregate demand and national income. Note that the slope remains unchanged in this scenario. This concludes the introductory video on aggregate demand. Briefly, we covered the aggregate demand equation, the income equation, the consumption function, tax rate, finding equilibrium in the short-run model, and the factors affecting the slope and position of the aggregate demand curve. Please watch the second video, which explains how to find equilibrium in the goods market.